thank you for being here. We're going to be talking a bit about the UCLA Alumni Mentor Program and especially how it can serve our graduate students during this webinar. We do serve our undergraduate students as well, but for just the specificness of the student population that we're serving, we wanted to let you know that the content today will be more focused toward our graduate students. The mentor program is part of a suite of programs that the UCLA Alumni Association has. We have a variety of different programs from digital resources to networking, also partnerships on campus and collaborations with offices like the Career Center and beyond. Our Alumni Association is committed to the success of our alumni and our students and their professional journey. And the mentor program is a signature program that we've been doing for, you know, almost 15 years. And so as the program has grown, it's definitely served more and more students. The mission of the program is to strengthen the Bruin network and to also enable our alumni from all over the globe to share their professional and personal experiences and expertise with current students. There's nothing more powerful than the Bruin network. And when Bruins help Bruins, you know, so much can happen. And so this mentor program has been a phenomenal way for our Bruin graduates to give back and help our students that are going through the campus today. Some of a little bit about the program impact. Last year, we served about 2,000 students that were part of the program. About 977 alumni were engaged. Many served multiple students as their mentors. And we had over 20 graduate and PhD programs that we were able to serve through their students that were part of the program. We had a wonderful showing of male and female mentors as well, which is amazing because, you know, we always want that balance and diversity there in our mentors. For more information about the grad mentor program, the website is below that you can learn more, but I'll be sharing a little bit about that today and some of the specifics. Many of you may be wondering too, you know, what does it mean to be a mentor? And so we have a quote from Coach Wooden, and the word mentor is both a verb and a noun. It is simultaneously something you do and something you are. The first definition is one that you can control, and the second one isn't. In other words, you can make a conscious decision to sit down with someone and share wisdom, experience, and encouragements. That is mentoring. And what we're really hoping to be able to empower all our alumni to do is to be able to share those three things, share their wisdom, experience, and encouragement for those that are coming behind them, especially our students and graduate students who are going through very specific experiences through the different programs and dissertations and so many different things that are very unique to the graduate student experience. Many people come in thinking, okay, well, what kind of mentor do I wanna be? And so these are three different areas in which we oftentimes see mentorship. We have personal mentors in our lives, and oftentimes these are teachers in our life to help us, you know, find an effective way to live. Oftentimes these people can be our family members, close friends. Sometimes we have professional mentors, and these are often people that are models for our career and professional success that we're hoping to achieve. There's also something called a leadership mentor. These are oftentimes people that we aspire to be inspired, that we oftentimes may not know them, but we really enjoy their style and hope to model ourselves after them. And for our mentors that are here today, oftentimes we think, as a mentor, am I signing up to be all these things? And the answer is no. You know, if you would like to be and that develops in your relationship, that's wonderful. But what we're asking you today too is to really think about, can you be a professional mentor for a current graduate student? Can you share your path? Can you share your network? Share how you got to where you are today and give them that encouragement that they may be seeking to really be able to navigate the year ahead. And so sometimes the personal mentorship and the leadership inspiration that can come as your relationship progresses. But, you know, coming in today, you know, I just want to encourage you to say, hey, let's start with just being a professional mentor, being a great model for a current student to share how you've moved forward. And a little bit about our mentor pairing process. Some of you may be familiar with different mentorship programs, whether that's through your undergraduate or graduate career or even through a workplace. Our mentor pairing process is, we call it student initiated, but then alumni powered. In that, our student will initiate their request. And so to be able to say, hey, I'm interested in being a mentor, you can raise your hand by creating a UCLA One profile, and I'll show you a little bit about how to do that today. You create your profile, note that you're interested in being a mentor, and then student requests will begin October 20th, where you will then review those requests and decide if you want to take on these students as mentees. You'll select your students, and you have until October 30th to do that, to review your request and select them. And then once you've decided and you have accepted your student as a mentee, your mentorship will begin with communications over the phone, and especially in this current environment, it will most likely will be encouraged it to be a virtual mentorship until it is safe and healthy to continue to gather together. So a little bit about how you go about raising your hand. The platform to do that is UCLA1.com. That is our UCLA professional networking platform. And on the platform, you'll be able to know whether or not you're interested in being a mentor. If you are, you go to the left side of the screen with the alumni mentor program here, and you're able to go to settings, and you're able to note how you would like to participate and help students. If you're interested in being a mentor, you click on the offer mentorship, and then you click on UCLA Alumni Mentor Program. If you don't want to be inundated with requests because you might be very popular, you can note how many requests you're interested in receiving at a time. And if it's 5, 10, 15, you can note that here and you can update your student request limit. And then after you've noted that in the profile, we also want you to go to edit your profile here and add in the answer to why I want to mentor a graduate student. What are you hoping to achieve? What do you want to share? What experiences would you like to, you know, walk with your students through? You can add information there to give your students something a little bit more to learn about, so that they, when they are selecting a mentor to request, they can see a match there and will send a request. And some of you may be wondering, well, what does a request look like when that happens? And so this is a little bit of a view for you to see. In the left-hand bar, after you've selected that you're interested in being a mentor, under mentor requests and approvals, you will see, if you click on that and a student sends you a message, you will see these pending requests here. And so just for our mentors to know is that students are only allowed to send one request at a time. And the reason we do that is we don't want students to abuse this tool and send so many mentor requests that they're able to actually accommodate. And so we don't want our students to then be taking up a lot of mentors and then maybe saying, oh, never mind, right? We want our students to be very thoughtful about how they move forward and choosing the mentor that they think is the best fit. So Kyle here sent me a request. You will receive much more information in your request because you'll most likely have more text there to read and review. If you like the student and you would like to move forward in your mentorship, click on accept, and then that will connect you as officially a pair. You can then begin your mentorship, whether that's connecting through UCLA One, or you can take it off the site and you can connect through Zoom, any other video chatting or video conferencing tools, or even over the phone. We know that, you know, getting that started may take some time, especially in a busy season, especially at the beginning of the year or for work. So, you know, we definitely ask that you connect with your student so that you can set the terms and the, you know, kind of the preferences that you're looking for. However, if you decide that the student is not for you, we encourage you to decline them. Don't worry, you won't break their hearts, you won't ruin their day. They will move on and they will find another mentor. Because if you're not able to accept them, their request is sitting in your mailbox and then they're not able to make another request. So definitely decline them. It's totally okay. They can always connect with you and just, you know, introduce themselves, do an informational interview. But be sure to decline if you're not interested in taking them on for the commitment of the year. And of course, with the program, we hope that, you know, you will stay in connection throughout the year, and we will talk with our mentors about how they stay connected with their students. But we will provide you resources throughout the year. So whether that's staff to answer any questions that you may have about how do you get your students engaged, we will have an orientation and training materials for you to set that first conversation that you have together. And then also we'll have online resources and monthly newsletters for you as well. So then that gives you ideas of how you want to connect. However, again, communication is key when it comes to this mentorship. Your students will, we will encourage your students to ask you for ways that you can help them. You know, I think that oftentimes our mentors share that, oh, I didn't know what they wanted. We don't want that to happen this year. And so we're going to be telling our students to be more upfront and clear about what they're hoping to get out of a mentorship. So also, just to close my portion of the program, wanted to share some key dates. Again, please create a profile by October 12th, because then our students will begin to review profiles. October 20th is when student requests will begin, so be sure to check your inboxes. You will get an email notification if you've noted that you would like to receive emails from UCLA One, that you've gotten a message, but if you've noted that you don't want email requests, please be sure to check the website. October 30th is the deadline that we ask our alumni to confirm or deny your student request, because our students are going to be prepping to either send another request if you want to decline them, or they will reach out to you if you accept. And then November 17th is when we'll have our graduate student program kickoff, where we'll have an orientation and then also give you and your students an opportunity to connect as well. And so just to close my portion of the time before we jump into our speakers, just want to end with a quote from Coach Wooden. As an old saying goes, we stand on the shoulders of giants. It is our responsibility to make our shoulders available for the next generation to climb. I know that in my career, I've been impacted by some amazing mentors that continue to spur me on to give back to the next generation. And we're so thankful that you're here, even just considering being a mentor, to be able to lift up the next generation of our students, and especially our graduate students who need our help more than ever. And so now I want to invite JP Santos, who is the president of the Graduate Student Association. He's here to talk a little bit about his experience, and then also some of the things that he has, some of the reason why we created the program for our graduate students. So JP, if you could come up.
Hey everyone, thanks Gloria for the introduction. Hey everyone, just want to introduce myself real quick. I'm JP Santos. I'm a PhD candidate, fifth year in the Department of Electrical Engineering. And I'm hoping to defend my dissertation this coming spring. But yeah, so one of the things that I've worked on last year in GSA and this year as GSA president is that I've actually reached out to the Alumni Association just asking for their assistance, because one of the things that many of the graduate students that I've asked me as GSA president is their ability to network with those that are closely aligned with their interests and maybe perhaps professional or even career, but also someone just to ask advice and kind of how to navigate graduate school. For those of you alums that are probably very keenly aware of how graduate school is, not just at UCLA, but in general, graduate school is a little bit more different than undergrads. In a sense that, for example, especially if you're doing research, you're closely dependent to your advisor or your PhD committee or your research committee. And pretty much the resources you know is highly dependent on how well-versed your committee or advisor is when it comes to navigating UCLA campus. So because of that, there's a lot of siloing that happens in graduate school, and a lot of graduate students just feel completely isolated and just feeling that, you know, there's just this difficulty to really navigate graduate school. And so I reached out to the Alumni Association because I knew that we have a strong Alumni Association network. After all, UCLA is the number one public university. So I really wanted to seek out if there's a way that the Alumni Association can specifically target graduate and professional students who really want this type of relationship that really centers around more closely aligned with their, for example, their research interests, their work interests, perhaps philanthropic interests. And sometimes just asking them, for example, how to just navigate, for example, graduate school in general. So I know, for example, our graduate students are really, really interested in kind of gleaning from the experience of alumni and how they, you know, perhaps finished a certain type of program, what kind of resources are really available to them. And really just trying to navigate, for example, perhaps one of the difficult ones, which is the student PI research advisor relationship. And so I'm really excited about this program. I know a lot of the students that participated in this program were really thankful to the Alumni Association for even hosting something like this. And, you know, I really want to let you let the Alumni Association know that this is really, really important part of the fabric of network that graduate and professional students are really seeking, because they really do want to glean and really understand some of the experiences that you have had in your graduate school experience. And I know that's going to become very instrumental in how they successfully navigate their graduate and professional school experience here at UCLA. So, you know, I guess and just in conclusion, I just want to say that I'm really thankful for you for even viewing this webinar or even participating in a webinar right now. And I know that a lot of the graduate students will really, really appreciate your mentorship as they're really seeking out how to navigate, especially right now during this pandemic, professional life, and just, you know, seeking out how to finish their program as in the years ahead. So thanks again. And I just, you know, thank you so much for participating in this program.
Thanks, JP. Thank you for your leadership too and wanting to create a program like this. And so we're excited to introduce our mentor panelists that are here today. I have Mike Antos and Margarita Luna, who all have advanced degrees from UCLA. And so I will turn it over to them to introduce themselves. And then we have some questions prepared just to share a bit about their experiences. And then we'll also take questions from the Q&A after. So if you have specific questions, feel free to add them into the Q&A. So I'll start with Margarita. If you could introduce yourself.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Gloria, for inviting me to be part of this today. My name is Margarita Luna. I'm a senior program manager at the California Endowment. I've been there for over 13 years now. And I am I'm a true Bruin through and through. I went to undergrad. I have a graduate degree in social work as well as a graduate degree in public health. And I'm very happy to be here on this panel today. Thank you.
And next we have Mike.
Hi, everybody. I'm Mike Antos. I work for the company Stantec. I'm a senior integrated water management specialist or a watershed social scientist, depending upon which business card I hand you. I'm also a visiting scholar at UC Irvine's anthropology department. My graduate degree is from UCLA. I graduated in 16. I've been working in the LA water, watershed, and climate adaptation circles for about 20 years now. I'm really excited to be here. Thanks again, Gloria, for bringing us to this discussion.
Thank you both. So we'll jump into my first question, which is, what motivated you to click on that, you know, button to say, I'll be a mentor, or even, you know, taking on your student? What motivated you and what encouraged you to take that on?
I guess I'll start. So what motivated me is that mentorship has always been an important part of my life. I've drawn the support and strength from so many mentors who helped me get through undergraduate and graduate school at UCLA. And so when I saw that as an opportunity, I certainly wanted to jump on it. When I was in graduate school, I had a difficult time navigating because there wasn't a program like this to help me do that. And so I actually helped to create the concurrent program that's there today, the MSW MPH program. And that was something that I had to learn how to navigate on my own. So I truly understand what that's like to really try to figure out how to have your educational needs met at UCLA as a graduate student. So I definitely wanted to help bridge that kind of support as much as possible. It has been a minute since I graduated from graduate school. It's been over 10 years. So there are certainly a lot of things that have changed at UCLA since then. However, I still feel like there's much to offer in terms of mentorship.
Thank you, Margarita. How about you, Mike?
Yeah, I guess my story is slightly different. I went through my graduate program as a working professional. So I was a little bit weird in that way that I had a full-time job while I was working on my PhD over in geography department. But as a watershed manager, watershed coordinator, which was, you know, what my profession has been for the longest time, I really recognize the value of networks and networking among people. And, you know, as a social scientist, you learn the rigor behind that. But as a professional, I kind of understood that piece. And I really have been blessed by being supported by a network of people who are very senior and very junior in the field. And I just like bringing that to bear for others and playing my part in the way that others have played that part for me. So when it was an opportunity to sign up at UCLA, I said, I mean, why wouldn't I, right? I get just as much out of it as the student might get from working with me.
Thank you. And that's so true. Oftentimes we learn a lot from the students as well. So the second question, I guess this ties into our second question, is what was the most rewarding aspect, or what has been the most rewarding aspect of being a mentor? Mike, you had shared with me before that you're still engaging with the student now. What has been the most rewarding aspect of being a mentor?
Well, I've, the student I've been working with, I've been able to share some of my professional connections with her, and she's been able to attend some of it. I've asked for people to have her come into events or meetings that I've been part of, so she's been able to meet others that I know, you know, and her enthusiasm and her interest and her connection, you know, that all my peers get to see, right? Like, it shines back on me too, right? So she's really excited for the opportunity, but everybody else is like, oh, that's so great that you're helping someone like that and bringing her along. And now she's asking us questions and we're hoping to do some work with her, right? So like, it is a mutual process, right? That a network is strengthened by all the pieces of it, right? So it's not just benefit one direction, it's benefit both directions. And yeah, it was funny when we were prepping for this call, you were saying, you know, so you worked with somebody last year, and I was like, well, I'm still working with her. I didn't realize that there was an end date. It didn't even occur to me, right? So I imagine that she and I will end up staying engaged as she moves off into her career once she's done and graduated. So it's a connection that will last. And like I said, it's sort of a two-way relationship. You know, it's not just me giving, I'm getting just as much.
Thank you, Mike. How about you, Margarita?
Yeah, I truly believe that you get the people that you need at the time that you need them. And so, my mentee is also someone who is in philanthropy. So it's actually, the relationship is so much deeper than just a mentorship relationship. It's a collegial relationship. And, you know, similar to Mike, you know, whether it's someone that's already in the field or someone who wants to grow in the field, this is a future colleague that you're supporting in their growth and development in this field. So I think that's really rewarding. I think the other thing that's rewarding is just getting to support someone and help them through difficulty, and also help them see those aha moments that can be just as important as they think about their career development.
That's actually a great segue into our next question. As you know, you said that you helped them through their career development. What were some of the strategies that you used to engage your mentee? And Margarita, you can start, but I know Mike and both of you are talking a lot about how you're helping them professionally. What does that look like? I think sometimes people are like, what does that actually mean? We can go in, you don't have to go into the nitty gritty, but maybe more specifically, because oftentimes I realize our mentors, our alumni, don't realize the power and the influence and the experiences that they have that students are looking for. So how did you engage your students?
Yeah, I think for me it was, I was a therapist in a previous life, and I'm also a trained life coach. So I have more of a coaching kind of mentality when it comes to mentorship, because I believe that folks really have the inherent answers already within them that are really linked to their values, and that's what's most important, right? Is unlocking where that connection is and alignment, so that they can make those decisions that mean the most for themselves in their own purpose that they want to walk in their life. And so I kind of come from that place, which is a little bit more squishy. I'm happy to be in the squishiness with them. And sometimes it is about, you know, the actual relationships and introducing them to folks that are in the sector, that maybe to have an informational interview or to learn more about the work that may be aligned with the work that they're interested in doing. So those are kind of some of the ways that I've approached it. I think we'll get into some of the advice that we have. So I'll definitely hold off on that until then.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, there's the specific example from this program, but there's a general example that's slightly different. The student that I've been engaged with is also a returning student. So she has already experienced kind of the professional world and is now back in school. So that changes the flow a little bit of what sort of support that she most needed. But in general, I've just been someone who would ask good questions, right? And, you know, helping helping refine points, and it's both been about the academic research project, but then also, you know, what elements to conclude. And then I've made introductions, and I'm on an advisory body in the region that was having a meeting. And so I asked them if that, you know, she could come along for the ride, this person I'm mentoring. And they're like, yeah, sure, no problem. So, you know, she got this opportunity to kind of be behind the curtain of a process that was related to her research, right? So it's facilitating those connections. We're at this point where she's considering including me on her committee for her master's program. So my mentorship has taken more of an academic spin, perhaps, than it might have otherwise, with someone who is in a slightly different position than she has.
But that's also great to note that I think all mentorships look different. I think a lot of times, you know, people think it has to go a certain way or it has to be these certain things. You know, I'm thrilled that the two of you are on this panel because you have very different styles and you have very different, you know, it seems like mentorships with your student, and that's okay. And that's, you know, like Margarita was saying, it's what the student needs at the time. And so I'm thrilled to hear, you know, how both your mentorships have progressed and are continuing.
Yeah, I mean, just to add to that real quick, please. You know, we burned a whole call just kind of feeling our way through the COVID pandemic together, right? Like we had an agenda that day to talk about something that she had written, and we ended up only getting about 5 minutes of that because we spent the rest of the time just kind of being human together in this weird moment, right? So those do happen, and you know, it's another person that you're engaged with to have conversations with. It doesn't have to be business all the time, every day, you know.
Yeah, you talked about the pandemic. How else has the pandemic, you know, for the both of you, impacted your, you know, maybe you came in as it was happening. How did that, you know, influence the kinds of conversations maybe throughout the year that you've had? You know, now we're, you know, going into what, 6 months of the pandemic? Has it impacted or grown, or how has that, you know, been played a part in your mentorship of the students?
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, I think it has taken more of that work-life, everything balance aspect in terms of the kinds of conversations that we have. There are also more strategic conversations that we have about planning for her future as well, and the kinds of choices that she's making today that could impact that. And so there's a lot of richness in these conversations. Sometimes, as Mike says, it's really just about, you know, checking in and seeing how we're doing and, you know, what's keeping her up at night. Sometimes folks just need a sounding board. They just need someone to talk to because they've already talked to someone else in their home to death about their dissertation or about their project, and now they need somebody else that has a fresh perspective. So that's the other way. I think also the pandemic in some ways makes it easier to be able to connect with mentees, mostly because everything is virtual now. And so, you know, trying to coordinate a meetup is different. It's more of a Google meetup than it is anything else. So that's made it a little bit easier in terms of the ability to do that.
Yeah, and it's this weird, I mean, we all know we're all doing it now. Even now we're doing it. It's this weird blend of intimacy and super distance, right? Like you are in my ear. You're in my home, but you're actually not here, right? And my mentee and I haven't actually met in person. I imagine someday in the future when we finally do, it'll be really both fun and strange, right? Because this is a new sort of space that we all are occupying right now. So I think that's mostly it. And then just also the fact that we're all under this extraordinary stress together is bonding in some ways too, in as horrible a way as it is, right? It is that bonding, and it gives you space to have someone to kind of, you know, talk about all these strains with.
Great. And so I have one last prepared question, but we might have other ones that will come up through this conversation, is what piece of advice would you give other alumni mentors or even prospective mentors who maybe aren't ready to raise their hand but are interested? What kind of advice would you give them as they're considering this next step?
Mike?
I can go first. Yeah, I mean, it's easy. Like, you go into the website and you sign in with LinkedIn and you hit a button and your whole profile rolls over and you say, I'm interested in being a mentor, and then you hit save and leave. And if it turns into a gig later, there's another opportunity for you to like evaluate whether it's the right thing to do. So like the cost of entry is extraordinarily low and you don't actually commit to anything until later. So taking that first step was super easy. I think I did it at 11 o'clock at night on my cell phone before I went to bed. I was just like, yeah, I'll do this. Why not? And it ended up being an extraordinarily rewarding experience and relationship, and a person who will be a colleague of mine, you know, pretty much the rest of my career now. So the downside is very small. The upside is really big.
Thanks, Mike. How about you, Margarita?
Yeah, absolutely agree. It's definitely very rewarding. And I really appreciate just the ability to give back during this time in this way. And, you know, just the advice that I would give is, you know, a lot of folks are just looking for a sounding board. And so if you have advice to give, ask them if they want advice. Oftentimes we go into problem solving mode when folks are sharing problems, and oftentimes they just need to hear them themselves in order to figure out what the solution is. And so just actually hearing it out loud, sometimes they find their own solution. So maybe give them a moment to pause, and silence is okay. You know, silence actually, you know, gives space for processing and thinking about what else is possible. And then the last thing I would say is just ask open-ended questions. You know, what and how are oftentimes the ways. Avoid whys as much as possible, because that just, you know, sends people into trying to defend their position. But what and how really are just really great ways to start questions that just open up possibilities and a conversation that could lead to exciting places.
Thank you, both of you. That was phenomenal advice. I know that we have someone in the chat that actually asked, you know, that she's mentored several times and they find that, you know, maybe after a couple calls, someone's not as interested. And it sounds like the two of you may have had students that maybe were a little bit more proactive, but what kind of advice, I guess, would you give mentors that may be trying to figure, you know, how do they negotiate this relationship? Maybe their student isn't as responsive. And I'm also happy to answer from our staff point of view, but just from your experience, you know, have you had moments in your relationships that did feel like, oh, I haven't heard from her in a while? How do you re-engage or reignite that?
Yeah, I try to set from the beginning like a conscious relationship and let them know what I'm expecting in the relationship. So I let them know that if we set up a time, I expect them to communicate with me or to show up. And then I also let them know that this is really led by them. And so, you know, if they need my time, they need to reach out to me. There are some folks that are really motivated and, you know, schedule in advance, which I'm very happy for, because then I have time in my calendar set aside for them. And then there are just folks that just want an informational interview. They just want a one-time conversation, or maybe it's a couple times, and that's fine too. And I've experienced that at UCLA too, especially with undergrads. And so they are still trying to figure out how to manage a mentoring relationship. And so oftentimes just being available and letting them know that your door is constantly open is just a way for them to just reach back out when they need you.
Thank you, Margarita.
Yeah, I would agree with almost all of that. The one of the most important skills I was ever taught was how to manage up. And I'm actually explicit with that when I'm working with mentees and saying like, listen, I'm here as your resource, so you need to manage me. You need to schedule me when you need me. You need to give me deadlines if you want me to look at something. You need to manage me. It's not the other way around. And, you know, not everybody catches that right away, so it's a teaching process. But, you know, that's really what I strive to do, because that way they stay invested. And if somebody doesn't want to do that and they don't, I'm not necessarily going to chase them down and try to turn it around for them. You know, if somebody wants to commit to doing that, they can. Yeah. It was one of the challenges. I mean, when I was at UCLA as a student, I helped try to put together a graduate student research group on water. And one of the challenges I had there was not all grad students sort of have yet learned that networking is one of the most important things to do and learn how to do. So I think that's maybe feedback back to you, Gloria, and your team.
Yep.
Is that, you know, teaching the students the significance of developing networks and learning how to do that networking is something to teach. And I think the people who are going to reach out to us and those of us on the call that might join in, they might already be over that hurdle, but they might only be just barely over that hurdle. So mm-hmm. helping them kind of come to grips with the value of what they've, the step they've taken and how to really extract value from us and how I'm actually eager for them to do it that way. That's a key piece to that, those first couple of calls.
I so appreciate that, Mike, you know, because I completely agree with that. I think that sometimes, you know, I was an undergrad that went straight to graduate school. So I was still very much learning and did not know a whole lot. I did not have any work experience and didn't really understand networking and the value of it. And so there are going to be some graduate students that are going to have that kind of experience as well. And there is a teaching process. There is that developmental process for them too. So maybe it's not important to them, but eventually they will realize how building networks will be important to their career.
And thank you, Mike, for that feedback. We are doing a series of informational sessions for our graduate students to share exactly the types of things you're talking about. I think, you know, as we want to train our students to be more proactive about just their discovery process, I think even that they may feel pressure, like, oh, I don't have the exact answer or the question asked, but this is about building a relationship. And what does building a relationship really mean? It's nurturing, it's asking questions. You know, and I know that sometimes, like Margarita mentioned, maybe they're just interested in doing an informational interview, that they weren't necessarily prepared for a mentorship per se. But sometimes if they're prepared for the first two, maybe informational interviews, hey, let's continue to build the relationship. Can we move forward? And also I want to empower both the student and alumni to say, hey, I think, you know, we've gotten into a good place and I don't have any more questions. And so I'm going to just end the mentorship so that if you wanted to take on another mentor, you could do that or they could do that, right? And so I think a lot of times it is also just being clear, like you're saying, Mike, to manage up and to be clear, Margarita said, like, this is what I'm able to do, that the student should also be able to say, this has been great. And I think I'm ready to, you know, ask another person to be a mentor, right? And so, and that's okay, right? And that's okay for us to say, hey, let's move forward. And they may not be together, but at least we were able to help each other during this time. Yeah. And for those of us, you know, I know that Mike mentioned, like, oh, I wasn't sure that this ended, like, you didn't know that it ended because it's continuing. You know, that's something that is, you know, that's what we hope for, is that you continue the relationship. But if someone is in a position where that they're good and that they feel like, oh, I've committed to this person for the year, or even if it's shorter or longer, but they don't necessarily need to be an official mentorship relationship, they can go in and they can, you know, cancel and not, or just to end the mentorship, right? And so what we're able to do in the with the technology, the platform, is you're able to say, you know, we're going to end the mentorship because we're good, we're done. And so, you know, I think a lot of the ways of teaching our students to end, to start something right, is also to end something right, right? Like to say, you know, thank you, and to be able to move forward. So for any of you, you know, when you found that, you know, with your mentee, were there ever moments that you were like, oh, I don't know how to help you? How did you get out? You know, how did you move through that? Or did you, you know, I know sometimes with some mentors, they feel like they have to have all the answers all the time. But how did you move through that process? If maybe they asked for something and you're like, oh, that stumped me, I don't know what to say. How did you move through those situations? And if you didn't, that's okay. You know,
Mike, you got something?
Yeah, I'm thinking back to the 6 or 8 months or however long it's been. And I don't really know that that came up. I guess, the closest to that perhaps is trying to sort out what's enough and what's too much, right? And, you know, the person I was working with, she was at a spot in her academic path and her thinking about the future. And, you know, there's a lot of creative directions that she could go, but it also would be not the right moment to be, you know, pushing down those paths, right? Let's focus on getting this thing done. And I think, both she and I had to work together to be like, oh yeah, let's save that for when you get into your PhD program. I'm not going to introduce you to that person because it'll be very difficult to get through, but let's try this person instead. So like trying to hit the right amount of work together as opposed to going too far or too short, I guess. And that's not exactly the question you asked, but that's the best example I have, I think.
Great, thank you.
Yeah, I think for me, because I kind of come to mentorship from a coach approach, it's not about centering me or my experience or any of my wisdom. Whenever there's an opportunity that to really unpack something, that's when it gets really juicy, for me at least, because then it really gets to understanding what's underneath, what are not just the strategies that we need to think about, but what are the feelings that oftentimes point to, you know, where she needs to actually make a decision to move in that direction, right? And so, I think that's actually the juiciest time is when, you know, we're unclear about where to go forward. And that's when you really start thinking about what's possible.
Thank you, Margarita. And thank you, Mike. I think I want to invite JP back on with us just to take on any other questions I think some of our participants may have. But thank you so much for, first and foremost, for offering your time, for saying yes, for raising your hand and saying, yes, I want to help. And, you know, I'm so thankful that you both have had very positive experiences with the program. And, you know, JP, this was back in March or April when we were saying, hey, like, well, actually, we wanted to do something for graduate students before then. And then the pandemic hit and we thought, should we start it? Should we do it? We were actually very nervous because we didn't want to put our alumni in a position where they would feel, you know, we're all going through stuff. But I'm so thankful that the both of you said yes and have had such positive experiences. It's definitely what we hope to be able to achieve. But we know that not everyone is like that. Not every experience is like that. But, you know, we're thankful for what you've been able to share with your students and to be able to contribute. So thank you both. I wanted to open it up to our participants if anyone had any other questions. I know that Shayna actually asked about the platform, if you might get requests from undergrads and graduate students. And the answer is yes, you may. In the sense that, you know, again, this is a platform and they can send the request. However, in your profile, there is a question why you want to mentor a current graduate student or mentor a current undergraduate student. If you don't fill out the undergraduate student, that's a marker for them to say that you're interested in just a graduate student. But if you are interested in both, you can answer both questions. And then if the undergraduate student decides that they really like you and you would like to be a mentor, you can decide whether or not you would like to move forward. There is no pressure for you to have to take an undergrad if you're really hoping to have a graduate student. And also, we had another anonymous attendee ask about their graduate program being an executive MBA program, and that's not a typical Bruin experience. But I also wanna, you know, I know, Mike, you said that you were working and doing your PhD. So do you have any thoughts about that as to not having a typical Bruin experience?
Yeah, I saw that come across, and I think my at the end of the day, it was not my experience at UCLA that was the most important piece of my experience in the mentorship. It's the fact that I'm a little bit deeper into my career and my life than the person I was helping. So I think anyone, particularly if you're in a position to be taking an executive MBA, it's very likely that you have wisdom and experience to share. So I would encourage you strongly to get involved, even if it's not with others who are in the same program as you followed.
Yeah, I would agree. And actually, those interdisciplinary kinds of mentorships, I think could actually be really exciting for people who are not, you know, you're not in the same field or not in the same kind of discipline. And so, you know, right now my current mentee is an MBA student, and that is not at all my experience. You know, I'm in social welfare and public health, background. And so it's been really great to hear from her and learn from her as well. So, you know, those cross-disciplinary, I think, is just as important.
Thank you. JP, did you have anything that you wanted to add, especially when it comes to like the interdisciplinary? I know that you're serving as a president of the Graduate Student Association. Do you have any other thoughts around mentors that may have different paths or different experiences?
Well, I think like I would agree with pretty much the panelists. I think that a lot of people think that my experience may not be relevant, but that's exactly what graduate school is. It's so niche, it's so unique, and I think any alumni experience that one may have can really be fruitful for a graduate and professional student at this moment in time. You know, for example, I know some graduate students are not really heavily in wanting to go into academia. And so they want to seek out alumni mentorship that really would steer them in a more philanthropic way, more entrepreneurship, or whatever way they're seeking. And so I think like this interdisciplinary mentorship would really be beneficial to those students. I know, for example, specifically MBA students that are really looking to branch away from business per se, and really seek out, for example, engineering or medicine or even the social sciences type of atmosphere. And so I think I would kind of encourage the Alumni Association or the alums that to not dismiss their personal experience in their graduate school, because I'm pretty sure that you will find a graduate student who will really think that your experience, and kind of like what Mike said, in your experience now as a professional will be really beneficial as they navigate their graduate school experience.
Thank you, JP. I'll take a question now from Steve. He asked like how many mentors are currently in the program? Is there a strong demand for mentors? Is there a wait list or anything like that? And to be honest, you know, we actually start each year anew. And so, you know, our system right now, we have, you know, we basically have said for those who maybe have raised their hand before, we actually are refreshing it so that, you know, our mentors are more current. In the past, when we've left mentors there, maybe they signed up 2 years ago and they haven't been checking their profile. And so we want every year to be new. And I will say there is, you know, more and more as our students are now going to be taking their fall quarter in a remote learning environment, there is a need for mentors, especially as students are navigating their programs from home. And so, you know, there is that this need for students to connect with people that are in areas that are, you know, aligned with them professionally, or even if as they're exploring other ways that they can use their degrees. And so we don't currently have a wait list because right now we're in the alumni recruitment phase. So students have not been told yet, they haven't started school just yet. But when they do, we will be telling them to, you know, review profiles and send requests. And so right now we're just asking alumni to raise their hands and say that they're available because, you know, as we're talking to our colleagues in the Career Center, colleagues that are, you know, working in our, you know, departments, and, you know, people like JP, there is a need. And so we want to make sure that we are inviting our alumni to be able to answer the call. So when students start their first couple weeks of school, they're ready to also start their mentorship relationships. JP, I don't know if you're able to share, you know, from your side of things as you're planning for the year ahead as a student and as the president, you know, do you see, you know, students, you know, thinking of ways that they can supplement their degrees that they're, you know, learning from home, but are there other things that you're hearing as well?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that's where I think these mentorships are really, really important, because I think a lot of graduate students are not necessarily aware of all the resources. So I think once they see that, oh, the Alumni Association has this program for mentorship with graduate and professional students, I know a lot of graduate students are excited about that. And again, like a lot of graduate students in the past have provided me the feedback that they really want to really learn and glean information from the vast Alumni Association network that UCLA has. We have one of the best alumni associations out there. So shout out to the Alumni Association. And so the graduate students, I think, and professional students really recognize that. And I think, for example, I think that the graduate students really would like to seek that out. And so I'm more than confident that there's graduate students, especially now in this pandemic, when, you know, kind of like what Mike was talking about, kind of like just having that human moment with a professional, like say, hey, like, you know, how do I navigate this? I don't know what to do. Kind of just having, even like Margarita was talking about, just kind of helping kind of provide some insight, or just even just listening someone to have a sounding board. I think graduate students really would appreciate that from the alumni.
Great, thank you.
And just say something, Gloria? Yeah, it just kind of makes me think about how, you know, I would ask you all to really think about your own experiences in graduate school at UCLA and how they went, and whether or not you could have benefited from a mentorship kind of support. And this is your opportunity to give back to other students and future colleagues.
Thank you, Margarita. You know, I think what's interesting is that our graduate students are actually incredibly diverse, you know, whether it's their personal situations that is diverse, you know, some have families, some are, you know, just starting into, you know, they just graduated from college or something like that. But then also, I think a lot of times when it comes to the mentor-mentee relationship, many times graduate students, maybe they have connections within their programs, but they could be looking to you and asking, hey, I'm really interested in what you do. How are you doing it? Like Margarita's situation, they don't have the same program, but she wants to get to where Margarita is. So the experience will be very diverse and they will be very different than potentially what an undergrad would be like. But it seems also too, from what our mentors have shared, it can get a very rich as well, because there is that, I think, more focus, I think, from our graduate students who are very clear about why they're here at UCLA. And so there is a different experience there for our mentors who decide to mentor a graduate student, but I think it'll be quite rewarding too if you're able to find your rhythm and find some common ground and common goals.
Yeah, can I just say, Gloria, I'm sorry to jump in so much. I just love you and that you're offering this to graduate students. I've also mentored undergrads, and I can totally agree that the experience is very different. For undergrads, it really is about helping them navigate and helping them understand, you know, the various programs and opportunities at UCLA, the deadlines, and just helping them sort of, especially during this pandemic, it's even more anxiety producing for so many of them that are very new to, you know, a university kind of setting, right? Graduate students are on a whole other level. Many of them are really focused on their career. Many of them are really trying to think about how to maximize their educational experience. So many of them are paying for their own education out of their own pocket. So this is a real investment in themselves and in their careers. And so I could say that the mentorship experience with graduate students is so much more focused than it is for undergrads.
Thank you. And also, I was just thinking of what you're saying, you know, there is going to be, especially for alumni who are interested in this opportunity, you know, really do put more information in your profile, if you are able to be able to inform to the students who may be interested in working with you. It is as simple, like Mike was saying, you can click on LinkedIn and then it goes and you're good. But if you want to add more onto your profile to say, hey, you know, I did my master's program or my PhD program while with the family, or, you know, I was able to do this and this and this. This helps make the students able to understand what maybe you're able to share with them and able to glean from your experience as well. So just wanted to encourage our prospective mentors to say, hey, you know, just to spend a little time too, if you are able to say, hey, like, let me share more about myself, just so that there's more information there for both of you to make that decision to work together. We will be encouraging our students to add more on their profile or in their message to you so that you have a better understanding of what they're hoping to get out of the relationship. But you know, I know, thank you, Mike, that was definitely, we're gonna do our part to try to coach them to be able to really communicate what they're looking for. But again, I also encourage you too that, you know, like Margarita and Mike said, you know, whether it's managing up and telling them to, you know, really say how they want to engage with you, or even Margarita's like, hey, like, put time on my calendar. You know, these are all practical strategies for really being able to guide your student. Remember, I think a lot of times mentors defer to their students, and that's, you know, that's true. Like, they should lead, but also, you know, that doesn't mean that if you're not hearing back that you should then, you know, like, wait around for them. You know, that's, you know, your time is incredibly important to us, and we're thankful that you said yes. And so know that sometimes we have students that are gonna act certain ways, but we also know that there are amazing students out there that are ready to engage. So hope that those that have watched today feel inspired and, you know, are excited to be a mentor. Mike, did you wanna say anything?
I was just gonna add that, you know, as much as what you're just saying, that this is us giving back, and sure, but this is me getting more from UCLA, right? This is, UCLA is a gift that keeps giving, right? After all these years of, you know, paying to be there and getting a degree out of it. But this is just like a football game or coming to a concert or going to one of the museums. This is just much of me getting something from that relationship. So I appreciate it as a gift from the university as much as it is me giving back anything.
Wonderful, thank you. And thank you again for the both of you and all three of you for your time here today. Was there any last words that you wanted to say before we signed off? Just wanted to make sure I didn't miss anything, if there's anything else.
Go Bruins.
Yes, that's right, go Bruins. And so thank you everyone for coming today, for being, you know, coming and hearing about our mentor program. Again, if you are interested in the program, check us out. Our website is alumni.ucla.edu/grad mentor. You can learn more information about the graduate program. And also if you want to mentor undergrads, great, but you know, we're really excited that you're here and you're interested in really giving some time and experience and encouragement for our graduate students. We hope all of your loved ones and you are safe and healthy. And you know, thank you again for your time today. And we hope that you'll sign up to be a mentor. And like Margarita said, go Bruins. Thank you, everyone.